So welcome everybody. Thanks for attending this this talk. I'm going to touch two major subjects, namely logging and monitoring, and show you how you can do it in a very easy way. At least give you some hints on how you can attack the problem on how to get distributed application metrics, how to get distributed application logging going inside your own applications. So that's the goal. Just an indication, I will give two demos. One major part is the logging, and the other one is the monitoring. Just giving you some insights. If you want to replay the demos later on, at the last slide, there will be a GitHub URL where you can download the slides and can replay all the stuff that I will be doing in this talk. So, in my company, we create a lot of applications. And sometimes I ask myself, is the world going mad or am I getting mad? Sometimes I'm starting to doubt myself because I see applications popping up, getting smaller, and the only thing I get is, okay, I have an application, throw it in a cluster and make sure that we can get application logging and monitoring, etc. Should be easy. People forget that it's fairly difficult to get stuff right. So, is the world going mad or is me? Sometimes I have a feeling I'm going mad, but yeah. This guy is certainly mad. I don't want to get a political fight, but yeah, this is another one. And you have a lot of people on the internet that are mad. Bright people, some less bright people. They have all kinds of opinions. They express themselves on Twitter, on whatever thing you stuff you mention. You can find lots of nice examples. You can fill days, weeks with stuff like this, finding stuff on the internet. So, also there was a trend, and there is a trend, and it's totally fine, to where people started thinking, okay, I have a nice application, and the application works nice. We heard the term microservices, so we should cut it up in pieces, because, yeah, everybody does it, so we need to do it. So we come from a shitty monolith, for example, to a lot of shitty microservices. It's not that bad, but it brings a lot of problems. Why? Because actually, the people that are thinking about distributed computing, and not only microservices, but distributed computing, have one law. And that law is, don't do it until you actually need it. Nowadays, if I talk to architects or I talk to developers, the first thing they have in their mind, I need an application, it is a microservice. Why? Yeah, everybody does it. So sometimes I point them to this law. Do we really need it? Do we need the problems that come with that? And often is the case, no, we actually don't need it. We don't need to scale to the amount of Twitter users or the amount of Facebook users. And we run with 100 users, so why would I split it up in 50 microservices? So don't do it. Distributed systems, how hard can it be? That's always always the statement. You have done it once, so you can repeat that stuff 50 times. It's actually fairly difficult. Difficult in two cases, logging and monitoring. Let's first start the logging stuff. So logging is fairly simple, you would say. As an application developer, you create something, you put a log statement inside your application, and that's it, you're done with it. A lot of developers don't think on, okay, what kind of information do I need to provide in this log statement? What is the debug level that I'm going to, the log level that I'm going to introduce in my log statement, etc. So generating logging information is fairly easy. You have different kind of formats for that. So in an application, Spring Boot, Grills, whatever, you normally do log.info or log.debug or whatsoever. And at the end, there's a log message that's coming out, and that log message has a certain format. The format normally is in the common log format or the combined log format, where you have timestamps and that kind of stuff. So once your application developer start creating an application, make sure that you agree on a log format. That will make your life easier at the end. At the end, if you are on a DevOps area or whatsoever, and you need to process those log messages, it's always nice that you agree on a certain log format and you don't have to make different parsers or whatsoever to actually use that information. So agree upon common log formats. So you see some log messages around if you look through GitHub or whatsoever, or start some applications, you see all kinds of logging information flowing by, some useful, a lot of them not useful. My favorite ones, how did we end up here? being from a developer that actually does not know how the code flows and just, I don't know how you did that up here. So there should be an error somewhere. And yeah, you find all these kinds of messages, but this actually does not help. So you generated your log information, and at a certain moment you need to collect it. And need at least to spit it out to something. So you, in your application, you spit it out, and you can spit it out to your syslog. Nowadays, preferably, it's to standard out. So log collectors or whatsoever can read that standard out and do something with that information. So that information has been written. You need to transport it. And if you have one application, that's not a problem. But if you have multiple applications, multiple microservices, for example, then you need to think about how I'm going to process or transport those log messages. You have specific frameworks for that. So generating log information, getting that log information, and transporting that to another system. I will show you Fluentd in this case. But Logstash and Flume are also fairly nice. Inside the department, the company where we work, we have made a choice for Fluentd for its simplicity. I will show you later on how simple it is to set log parsers using Fluentd. So those are specialized transporters. They do something with that log information, maybe enrich it and send it to something else. And that something else actually means that that log information needs to get stored somewhere. And you have different storage options. You can put it in an S3 bucket. You can put it in Glacier for long-term storage. You can send it to Elasticsearch, for example, where you can easily query it. And you have some considerations for that. For example, the cost aspect of storing log information. One line is not a problem, but if you need to store logging information, let's say for a whole year, then you can easily run it to a high cost. And you should really think, okay, what am I going to do with this information? Do I really need it? Because the first remark from, for example, the test department or quality department, store everything. And they don't have any clue what the amount of money is that's involved with that. So you have different storage options, but also different costs associated with that. What we're going to do later on in the demo, we're going to store our log information in Elasticsearch. It's fairly easy to do so. Store that information locally, but if you store it locally, you can also store it remote. You need to analyze something, so you have your log information inside a storage option. Again, could be Elasticsearch, but could also be something else. You need to visualize stuff. In this case, you can use Kibana to visualize the information being stored in Elasticsearch, but you have also other options, Graylog, for example, to process that data. You can also do offline processing or batch processing using MapReduce on your log data if needed. At a certain moment, it's also nice that you get alerts on certain events. For example, if a message appears multiple times in a certain time frame, so that you get an alert, let's say something strange is happening or whatsoever. Or if you get no log information, that, for example, the service is gone or whatsoever. So you can get alerting also from these systems. What I would like to mention is that logging is something different than monitoring. So logging is what has happened to the system, how is the information flown through the system, and monitoring are really the aspects, how much CPU am I using, et cetera, et cetera. So there's two different aspects on on an application. Logging does not equal monitoring. So coming back to the first monolith, traditionally we have one application and that application generates some log information. For example, a Rails, or could be Grills application, doesn't matter. That application generates some log information, and at a certain moment you have a sysadmin that does a grab on the log or a tail or whatsoever. It works fine with one application, but if you have a distributed application, that doesn't work anymore. It's impossible to just do a grab on all those microservices. And also, if you, and I still meet those people that, for example, run their Docker containers in Amazon. They hop into, for example, a Docker cluster, and then they look where the container is, and they go into the machine and do a grab or a tail on the Docker logs, and then, boof, the container is gone and has spawned up onto another machine. And they go hunt that Docker container again. So that's stupid. So distributed logging, grab is not possible anymore. If you would do that, you end up something like this. You get a spaghetti, scripts, searching for Docker containers that are spun up somewhere, getting that information, etc., etc. It becomes a nightmare. So there's something what you need. You need a unified logging layer. And a logging layer is actually fairly simple. The picture looks more complicated than it is. A unified logging layer is actually stands for a process that captures your log information and a process that enriches your log information. So you have your collector nodes in this case. And those collector nodes are actually collecting your log information. And you have your aggregator nodes that actually aggregate log data and enrich log data coming from different collector nodes. You can even run multiple aggregator nodes, for example, but the concept is the same. You have multiple collector nodes, multiple aggregator nodes. So how does Fluentd come into practice? Fluentd actually implements this unified logging structure. Fluentd is an open source it's an open source project. You can contribute to it. It's also used as the primary solution for, I believe, in Kubernetes itself, but you can also can run it locally on other systems. And you have information coming into Fluentd, different sources. Can be everything coming from Apache logs, standard outs, Docker containers, doesn't matter. System logs indeed, and you have something which you can alert stuff on, analysis. So you have inputs and outputs. And in the middle, you have the log enrichment and maybe changing of the log data, etc. Anonymization nowadays is fairly hot. At least in my company, we need to spit out every personal details from log information. So our GDPR statements were heavily involved with how do we log stuff. So Fluentd, how is it implemented? It's an open source Ruby implementation, so don't get scared. It's Ruby's on a Grails conference or a Java conference. Ruby, and it should be slow. But actually, Fluentd is one of the fastest implementations you can get. Why? Because the fast stuff they wrote in C. So you have a Ruby engine and a C engine, and they work closely together. It's a pluggable architecture, so you can get all kinds of plugins from the internet, from Fluentd itself. And this gives you an example. So we have Fluentd running, just as a process. Data coming from a web server that writes to standard out. That information goes into Fluentd, and Fluentd does something with it and actually stores it in Elasticsearch. What does Fluentd do with that data? It actually creates events from that data. So an event looks like the following. You have a tag, you have a time, and you have a record field. A tag is where is the information coming from. Could be a service name, could be a Docker container ID, whatever. So you can make up your tags, whatever you want. A timestamp and a record. And a record is actually the log data that you shipped to Fluentd. Fairly simple. So if you would have an event like this, so just a HTTP access log, this would translate to the following event, HTTP access log with a specific tag, a time, and the record inside it. So if you run Fluentd, you need to have some configuration, and in my opinion, that's something where Fluentd really shines. It's the simplicity. We went with Logstash for a certain amount of time, and we got tired of the whole difficult configuration. And within days, we got Fluentd, or within a day, we got the whole Fluentd stuff up and running due to the simplicity of the configuration. So if you have a configuration file, you have the sources where stuff comes in. You have matches, so we have log information with tags. And matches actually determine, okay, what do I need to do with this log information? Do I need to do a certain operation on it, et cetera? Filter out data, so that's also the filter configuration where you say, for example, specific log information, I will filter it out, or I will do something with it, and a label. So this gives you an idea how a simple configuration could look like. This is a configuration file of Fluentd, and this tells Fluentd, I accept everything on an HTTP port. That's it. I'm going to make it somewhat more difficult. This is an input source, and this is going to tail a file, so it's not always needed to send information to Fluentd. You can also instruct Fluentd, look for the information inside a file if you want. So if you, for example, have a server running and you spawn up Fluentd on that server and say, look on that file and send everything to a collector node, just have a configuration like this and it will do it like that. So in this case, the tail actually looks for a file. Instructs Fluentd, this file has a specific format, Apache format, so you don't need to do, let's say, express how the information in that file looks like. So Fluentd will actually put out all the fields and send that to Fluentd itself. Filters, if you need to do add some stuff to a record. In this case, all information flows in. You have a filter and you add something to a record. In this case, a host param. If you need to write to something output, so the matchers, this is a simple example again to MongoDB. If you need to write to MongoDB, just have an annotation, Mongo, and you're done. Or annotation, add type Mongo, send it out, and it will be stored in MongoDB. So let's do a small demo. I will first show you how this stuff looks like. So this is the repository which you can get on GitHub. It has two steps in it. So one demo for the logging and the other one for the monitoring. So we look to the Fluentd logger. I'm using Docker Compose. I will start Fluentd as Docker container. I have Fluentd as a container. Fluentd container itself, a Spring Boot application, Grails application that actually generates the information. I will spawn up Elasticsearch and I will spin up Kibana. And Kibana is something that I use to visualize the information inside Elasticsearch. This is the configuration itself. It looks a bit, a bit difficult, but actually it's not. So what I define over here, I define an input source at the top. So Fluentd will be listening on a certain port, and all information will flow in. I will filter out data, and filter out data mean I will do something with that data that comes in with a certain tag. So for example, this filter, I know that data tagged with this tag has Spring Boot log format. So that's why I filter all tags containing Spring Boot. I do something with that log format. For example, this is the stuff below here. People that are familiar with Logstash, normally you should do regular expressions, match this and match that. You have something called grok. And with grok, you can express yourself more easily, at least for me. If I spin up Fluentd later on, these percent thingies will be extended into awful regular expressions, which I would never be capable of writing. And I will add a timestamp to it, and I will send it out to Elasticsearch. So, time for the demo. Go to steps. Yep. You'll see immediately all kinds of errors flowing by because Fluentd is so quick and it started before Elasticsearch is started. But it will retry later on, so there's no information lost. But the first time, they'll say, yeah, I cannot find the Elasticsearch, so I will back off for a moment and will retry it in a moment. So I have my stuff running. Let's go to logging. First, I will generate some log data. Hello world, of course, the famous one. So if I look to this one, I generated some log information. And this is actually the log information that's coming from, is that visible? Yeah. So here you have the record structure that Fluentd created from it. You have the timestamp, you have the log level, etc. And now if you go to Elasticsearch, you can... Where is it? Bookmarks. So the first thing I need to do is create a connection. Management. Index patterns. Next step. I need to tell Kibana to where the time information is, because Kibana works with time. So I now create an index pattern. And you have your information flowing. So if you now would like to, for example, search for Spring Boot. You have your information. And you can filter on, for example, specific log levels or whatsoever. So it's fairly easy. So I spun up FluentD. I configured FluentD just listen on a port. For my applications, which are in Docker, the only thing I needed to do, so I did not do anything to my Grails or Spring Boot application. I just launched a Spring Boot application. And I told, in this case, the Docker log driver, use FluentD as a endpoint. So everything that goes to STD out goes to a FluentD address. In this case, it's localhost. And this is the tag Spring Boot demo.fluentd. So application with a log driver, no modifications, go to FluentD, and FluentD spits it out to Elasticsearch. I forgot that link to mention. All right. Monitoring. So we have our logging into place. Now we have logging into place. Now we need to do something about monitoring. We built a lot of prototypes in my company. And what we often encounter is I call it the scary movie, the happy developer. We have a developer that sits on a product, creates something, it will work. Yeah, but this prototype needs to go into production, let's say with 1,000 users. Yeah, it will work. It works with one, so it will work with 100 or 1,000 whatsoever. I have logging into place, so no problem. Then shit happens. So he built that application is running, etc. And yeah, logging is into place, so I can see stuff. But we missed something. So at a certain moment, that application went down. Of course, no logging information. So what could it be? We have no monitoring information. We have no clue what the CPU uses or what the memory uses was, etc., etc. So nobody noticed. This is something I told already. So why do we monitor? We monitor actually for vital signs. If my application is running, is my operating system running, is my CPU doing well, are all those metrics okay? It's more or less the same as being in a hospital. If you're in a hospital, you also are measured for vital signs, at least I hope. If you have a serious disease, you have some sensors attached to you and you see that little beep, and I hope that beep, beep, does that with everybody. But the same what we do with monitoring. You actually measure your application for vital signs. To be able to detect when things go wrong, but also to predict when things go wrong. For example, a nice use case in our department is we always want to know when disk space, for example, is going to fill up. So we can do predictive analysis. Let's say it will fill up in a week, it will fill up in 2 weeks, or whatsoever, to do that. So we have that monitoring information, for example, and we feed that into other systems that does predictions on how our systems evolve. And then, what do you need to monitor? For vital signs, of course, but you have all kinds of stuff that you can measure. You can measure your application metrics. You can measure how your services are doing. You can measure your operating system, your IT networks, etc., etc. But there's a lot of data coming from those systems. So if you monitor stuff, you have a lot of data. Running one system is no problem. Running 10 is no problem. But if you have 100 or 200 or more, then actually data becomes an issue. So we have a storage problem over there. Storage actually is not the problem. Actually, dealing with that data is a problem. So I can put it in Postgres, for example, and it will stay there. But if I want to work with that data, do some time analysis on it. Let's say I want to have CPU usage for the last 10 minutes or whatever, then I have an issue. Postgres, for example, just as a simple idea, is not able to cope with this amount of data and is not very happy with doing time-based queries. So we have something else. That's what we call time series database. And that's actually at the heart of a lot of monitoring systems. So if you look at InfluxDB as a monitoring system, I'm going to introduce later on Prometheus as a monitoring solution. They all have a time series database in them Because time is actually the critical solution. So what is time series? Or at least what is time series data? It's very simple. You have a date and a timestamp and some values. I cannot make it any more complicated. It looks a bit like this, and it depends a bit on what kind of implementation you take, but more or less the general feeling is, the general format is more or less the same. The naming are a bit different, so if you, for example, look at InfluxDB, they have different namings for actually the same format. So you have a measurement, in this case, so something which you measure. You have metadata, and you have the actual value of that measurement, and you have a timestamp. And the timestamp is in nanoseconds. So no microseconds anymore. You need nanoseconds granularity to actually make sense of that data. So if you look at monitoring systems and time series databases, InfluxDB is a solution. But Prometheus is another one, and they differ a bit in scope. So InfluxDB also does some monitoring stuff, but it's going to focus more or less on being a generic time series database. And Prometheus comes from the SoundCloud guys. It's also a time series database, but it really was created with a specific purpose, monitoring. And a time series database is more or less an aspect. InfluxDB is time series database is number one. And Prometheus, monitoring, and time series is number two. So the focus of those two companies, or at least products, are a bit different. How does Prometheus look like? Prometheus is open source, comes from the SoundCloud guys. It's a Go application, so you can download it and you can run it on every system you like. Run it on a Raspberry Pi, whatever. You're free to do that. So it's fairly easy. It has different components. It has one central thing, and that's called the Prometheus server. Prometheus server is where all data comes in. So that's actually the database, the central core of the whole system. If you have that central core, you need to talk to that core, for example. You have all kinds of client libraries. So you want to put something in Prometheus, then you have client libraries in Java, Go, JavaScript, whatsoever. There are a lot of them. So if, for example, you would have a Spring Boot application and you would like to store metrics of that Spring Boot application, you would add a dependency on some client library and add, for example, a custom metric. I will not touch on that, but for example, a small thing, if you want to have a metric, let's say how much time a certain function has been called, and a business function, it's 4 or 5 lines of code to actually expose a metric inside your application, which is consumable by Prometheus. You have a lot of exporters, so you have the central core, but then you have a lot of subsystems that actually provide data for Prometheus, and those are exporters, and you can download exporters for almost anything. You just run that exporter, and what happens, if you run an exporter, an endpoint comes available, and that endpoint produces metrics, which actually Prometheus will scrape. So there's a difference between also the Influx solution and the Prometheus solution. Influx uses a push model, where every system pushes data to Influx. Prometheus uses a pull model. It needs to know what kind of systems do I need to monitor. So it pulls information from those systems. There's a debate, pull versus push, 50-50. I like the pull model. It's also simple. So this is how it looks like in a picture. In the core, you have the Prometheus metrics database, runs as a separate process. You have the alert manager. The alert manager is also a piece of software coming from the Prometheus product that runs separate. So if you need to send out alerts, for example, if a container goes down, you just send an alert. And actually, the alert manager will take care of what do I need to do with those alerts. Do I need to send them via email or Slack, or do I need to call somebody or whatsoever? That's the alert manager. And you have a lot of exporters, and those exporters produce information which is consumable inside Prometheus. is een small list of exporters which are available. I can name them, but if you want to have information on those exporters, you can go to the Influx website and see which exporters are exporters are available. You just launch them and you have metrics available. The one we will be using later on in the demo is the Node exporter, and the Node exporter just gives me information about the system which I'm currently running. So if you have different systems, run the Node exporter on it. It's a very simple application. You can spawn it up as a Docker container, and that Docker container will give you information on the CPU use, network stuff whatsoever, give you information on that system. And that will be going, we will be using. So this is the, normally I do a demo and I do part by part, so now we will be one big demo. I will start Prometheus again with a Docker Compose file, and a lot of stuff will be started because at the end it is a big demo, but for this I needed to squeeze it in. So we will start Prometheus database, we will start Grafana again, we will start the alert manager. So if I stop a container, you will see an alert going out. On this side, at least on my host, I will start a Node exporter so I can get details on my system. And again, it's local system, I could also have it remotely. And I also start cAdvisor. cAdvisor is a project coming from Google, which actually exports metrics for Docker containers and all the Docker containers that are available. So if I start information, it is endpoint. So a lot of applications currently are coming out and have support for Prometheus monitoring by default. So let's go into that demo. Need to shut this down. DC. Now, Prometheus should already be there. So this is the central core of Prometheus itself. It's nothing special. The UI is fairly ugly. This UI on the Prometheus core is actually just meant to test out queries for your data, do some data-enabled stuff. They have another product called Chronograph, which is far more has more beauty, which you can use for this. But you can type an expression. So for example, if you need something on specific metrics, you can do something and see, okay, what was out there. Node, whatever, network, received bytes, execute. How do so this gives you information. So this simple query gives you information on the metrics I have for a specific metric. If I want to group or filter out this metric, I can do something like this. Device is ECH0. I only have this metric. This value. If I want to have the values for the last 5 minutes, I can do something like this. So we get a bit more. And what you can also do now is create a graph from it. And you need to have a function, rate, execute, and you can have graphs. No, I'm trying to zoom. Zoom doesn't work. So this Prometheus UI is just used to test out your queries and see what data is in. It has some status thingies. So as mentioned, Prometheus actually pulls remote systems, so it does not get the information automatically, but needs to pull information. In this demo, in the configuration, I've written static configurations, so Prometheus knows by startup already where I can find my systems that I need to scrape. This can also be done dynamically. For example, if you run your stuff on AWS, you can also use a dynamic configuration where Prometheus will ask AWS, give me all systems in this account, for example, that I have a specific label for I can imagine a label Prometheus monitoring or whatsoever, and it will pull that those systems and it will scrape them automatically. So for example, if you spin up a Docker container and it has that label or it has that information, Prometheus will already will get that information automatically. No need to do that manually. So this is the status stuff where you can see your targets. You have your alerts over here. Currently, in the background, I have a certain container running that's called ping. Just does a ping now and then. I will stop this container to see that an alert will actually fly out. Status. If you look at the configuration of, I will use the other one by the way. How Fluentd can be configured, or Fluentd, how Prometheus can be configured. It's fairly easy. This is the scrape config. You just statically add stuff like this, or do it dynamically, or whatsoever. This case is dynamically. So you start you start Prometheus with this configuration file, and you're done. Targets, alerts are done. Yeah. So graph, okay. I wanted to show you something else. I've always forgot that. If you want to see how those metrics look like, so I have different systems running now. No. Cannot be reached, of course. This is something different. I need to do it like this. Because on the Docker network, it looks for Node Exporter. And if now click on the link, it goes outside of well. So we need to pick it locally. Monitoring node export metrics. And these are, for example, other metrics. This is, by the way, this is the format that typically Prometheus endpoints provide. So again, you have a measurement and you have a metric. You have a measurement and you have a value. That's it. And Prometheus will collect this every now and then. Monitoring. Let's go to Grafana. Everybody familiar with Grafana? Yeah? Somebody not? No, Grafana is just, you can use Grafana actually just to visualize data. It has a lot of inputs. You can say fairly easy, use Prometheus as an input. And you can build nice dashboards with Grafana and give that to your business users or whatsoever. So I will log in into Grafana. Only thing I need to do now is to create a data source, add a data source, and I will call this data source Prometheus. This is the list with data sources actually for Grafana. So if you have something else than Prometheus, you can use that also. So Prometheus, it runs on my local system. I need to do this. Yeah. Not now. So I have a data source now, and now I can create a dashboard. If you're totally familiar with Grafana, that's fairly easy. Just create a graph, type in the same query as we did just with the node received bytes, and you get a graph. But there's also another option. Why do it yourself? If a lot of people already invested a lot of time and effort into it. So Grafana has also a collection of open source dashboards. It can have stuff like this. So this is the last 30 minutes. So without doing anything, I only needed to spin up Prometheus, spin up a Docker container as a node exporter to scrape that data, start Grafana, and I have my dashboards running, and you can tweak it as you like. So this gives me the information on my system, how much memory, you can zoom in, zoom out, or whatsoever. There's also another one. Import. So if you're into Docker containers, you have a Docker dashboard. Set Prometheus as the endpoint. And you have your you have your Docker containers. So you can see the memory uses, container uses, etc. So it's fairly easy. So last step, if I go to Prometheus again. I see that everything is working fine, Prometheus. That currently I have no alerts, so they are green. So let's stop the ping container, and then I also need to start Slack, because I configure that also. Get that out of the way. Over there. Where is my terminal? Docker. Stop. Ping. So what will happen now? Prometheus is instructed to scrape the data. And in an alert configuration, I said, okay, also make sure that I have a service called ping. And if this ping service does not report back within a certain amount of time, just raise an alert. It's fairly easy to do. If you have an alert, something like this. This is an alert. And you just can add alerts. So if the ping instance is down, so if I have no data for this container, if that data is gone, just raise an alert and mark it as being critical. And this critical is fairly important, because these labels actually instruct the alert manager on how to handle this alert. So if a alert comes in with this label, you have a alert rules, that's the other one. Alert rules. Jammer. No, where is it? Oh, this one. So we had a previous one, and that the label was matched critical. And if an alert comes in, so this is the configuration for the alert manager, you're totally free to choose whatever alert you want. You can name it page or whatsoever. And this only instructs a route for the alert manager. If I match something, and you can also match multiple ones, if there's something which with a label called severity and a value critical, I do stuff. In this case, I will send out a mail. Continue part is really important. If I would remove this continue part, then the only thing will happen is I will get a mail, because the notification chain will stop over there. So if you don't put this into place, you can spend hours. If you don't have the continue, then you will only get a mail and will not get a Slack message. Now, let's get back to our alert stuff. Need to refresh. And I have an alert. So I go to my alert manager to see also that component. Oh. Monitoring alert manager. So this is the alert manager. Separate piece of software. This is actually handling these alerts. So I have one alert. There's nothing special to see. You can silence, group alerts, whatsoever. Normally we just use this piece of software to send it out and do not do anything with it. Just being the gateway to our external systems. I send out a mail alert, so I'm using another Docker container for this, mail slurper. It actually acts as a testing container for sending out alerts. And looks, I've one alert that has been fired because I have no metric data from that service. And hopefully also my Slack has mentioned something. Oh, where is Slack on? Slack. DevOps. So there's an incident done. All right, let's go back. This was it. So it looks maybe like a lot, but if you start up Fluentd, if you start up Prometheus, the step to get that running inside your organization or inside your department or play around with yourself, it's fairly easy to do. It's no rocket science anymore. It's a couple of Docker containers, and you're done. Any questions? To have the full list, I need to see on the Docker website, but you have a couple of them. For example, AWS, you have a CloudWatch log driver. You also have you have a bunch of them.
I don't know.
Oh.
Yeah, for example, if you run a Kubernetes
Yeah? I'm not an expert on Kubernetes, to be honest. In my department, we usually use ECS, so an Amazon function for that. And the only thing we need to do, I cannot compare it to Kubernetes. Internally, Kubernetes is also using Fluke. But if we use it, let's say, in AWS, being in the ECS context, then the only thing we need to do is, when we start up a task, is have this little block, use Fluentd as a log driver with a DNS entry, and then we're done. Yeah. So we just add it as a small metadata part of launching a container. That's it. No? So if you want to play around with yourself, check out this one.